welcome everybody. Thanks very much for taking the time out of your busy schedule to attend this afternoon's event. I'm Anthony Skelton, and I'm the Associate Director of the Rotman Institute of Philosophy, and also Associate Professor of Philosophy here in the Department of Philosophy at the University of Western Ontario. I, of course, have the distinct pleasure of introducing this afternoon's speaker. Professor Aimee van Wynsberghe is currently Assistant Professor in Ethics of Technology at the Technical University of Delft in the Netherlands, and is co-director of the Foundation for Responsible Robotics. She has a PhD in Applied Ethics from the University of Twente, an MA in Applied Ethics from Catholic University of Leuven, and a BSc in Cell Biology from the University of Western Ontario. Professor Van Wynsberghe's research focuses on healthcare robots, humanitarian robots, delivery robots, and the potential development of ethical robots. She has published widely on these topics, and her work has appeared in a number of journals, including Science and Engineering Ethics and Ethics and Information Technology. In 2016, she published the monograph entitled Robots in Healthcare, Design, Development, and Implementation. Today, she is going to be speaking to us on the ethics of ethical robots, so please join me in welcoming her here today.
Thank you so much for being here. Happy St. Paddy's Day. Nice to see the green. Sorry, apologies that I'm out of green. So thank you also to the Rotman Institute for organizing this. It's a pleasure to be back at UWO and to speak for you today on the topic of ethics, the ethics of ethical robots. So I see some familiar faces in the audience who have seen me speak yesterday and maybe both days now. But for those of you who weren't at any of the previous talks, essentially my work revolves around this broad area called robot ethics. There are three dimensions to the study of robot ethics, the first being the ethics with respect to the designers who are actually making and or deploying the technology, the second being about the ethics of the robot users, and the third, the ethics of the actual robots themselves. So today, I'm really narrowing in on this dimension, the ethics of the robots themselves. So an overview of what I'm going to be talking about in the next hour. I'm going to begin by telling you, hi, a little bit about my journey, how I arrived at this topic. Robot ethics is a very unique and specific area. Then I'm going to talk about machine ethics in 30 seconds, just very quickly, so we all have a broad understanding of what I'm trying to talk about. And then what I would really like to do is to investigate the different reasons that machine ethicists have put forward for why we need robots to have some sort of ethical or moral reasoning capabilities. So I should also emphasize, yesterday I was giving more of a lecture-style kind of talk. This is what robot ethics is. And today I'm presenting more of a work in progress, so I'm really playing with these ideas. So I appreciate feedback from the audience on what you think or how rigorous my pushback actually is. So I'd like to present the reasons that the scholars have provided for why we need to have robots that have these capabilities, and then I would like to push back on these reasons to try and pull them apart or pick them apart. And then, of course, stress why this is such an important conversation to be having right now. The stakes are incredibly high, and leave you all with a take-home message that keeps you thinking well into this evening while you're drinking green beer. So, as Anthony mentioned, I did my undergraduate here at UWO. This is a picture of the NatSci building. I did my undergraduate in cell biology, so I'm very familiar with the campus. And at the same time, in the summers, I was a research assistant at CSTAR. And CSTAR is the Institute for Canadian Surgical Technologies and Advanced Robotics. And so in the summers, we were experimenting with the Zeus telesurgical system and the Da Vinci surgical system. The Da Vinci is probably more commonly known, made by Intuitive Surgical. So what we were doing as a team of researchers was, and for those of you who aren't familiar with surgical robots, the way that they work is the surgeon is sitting in a console and manipulates remote controls, has a visual screen in front of them, and that shows the surgical field, which is shown by a camera that's inside the patient. When the surgeon moves their hands or their fingers, a signal is sent over to the robotic arms that are inserted into the patient, and then the robotic arms move. So what we were trying to do was to introduce some sort of delay between when the surgeon moved their hands and when the actual arms, the robotic arms, would move. And that meant that the surgeon would see a delay on their screen. So we wanted to see, you know, up to how much of a delay could the surgeon still perform accurately? And also, could we introduce some variation? So not just a consistent delay of a half a second or a second, but, you know, going from a half a second to a second and back to a half a second and that kind of thing. So I was really looking at the technical details of the technology. And I was struck by a few things. I wasn't really focused on, you know, it wasn't about the robot performing the surgery. I was very much aware that it was the surgeon who was engaged in the surgery, and this was an apparatus or a tool to help them perform in a more sophisticated way. But what struck me was the distance that was now incorporated into the procedure of surgery, right? So you have the surgeon physically separated from the patient. And so this is quite a drastic transformation or evolution in the practice of surgery. So this really led me to ask, you know, about the general ethical issues when we're talking about robots in general or robots in particular healthcare contexts. What kinds of things should we be concerned about when we're thinking about the patient and this new technology that's introduced? Or what kinds of questions should we be asking about how the surgeon feels, right? This is a drastic change from how surgery used to be performed, hands actually in the patient or hands over top of the patient with endoscopic tools. And now you're not looking at the patient in the same way. You're looking at a very specified picture of the surgical field. So this led to my PhD research, which was trying to form a bridge between ethics, design, and the actual implementation of this technology. So how could I translate ethics into something that could be usable and useful for the engineer and the robotic designer? Now, the kinds of robots that I was actually looking at in my PhD, so now I'm out of the C-star space, I'm out of the, you know, focusing strictly on surgical robots, and now I was interested more in an incredible variety of robots like telecommunications robots, right? So a robot that allows you to have a discussion with your doctor when you're not at the hospital, when you're in your home, or when the doctor is not at the hospital, when you're there and the doctor is in a different hospital or at their home. Or in the top right-hand corner, you can see an exoskeleton that the nurse is wearing. So robots that could be used to help the nurse in their daily activities, to lift a patient in and out of a bed. Or in the bottom left-hand corner, this is an example of a robot that's used to not only remind patients to take their medication, but to actually give the medication to the patient, and then to watch to make sure that the patient actually takes the medication. And then in the bottom right-hand corner, this is the Paro robot. I don't know if very many of you are familiar with this robot, but it's a robot used in nursing homes or in elder care facilities. And the idea is that it provides some similar benefits to animal therapy. So, in stroking the robotic apparatus, you calm yourself physiologically, mentally, you're able to sort of calm down. So this is a great robot. If you can't actually have a dog or a pet in a care facility, you can have the same benefits by using this type of apparatus. But what really struck me while I was doing my PhD research and also afterwards was the range of roles that we were delegating to these robots and the range of appearances that the robots had. So we have some robots that are very machine-like and that are used for things like delivering sheets and medications throughout the hospital, right? That is the role that we have delegated to the robot. And then in contrast, we have this robot that I was talking about earlier that not only reminds you to take your medications, but hands over the medication to you and watches you as you take the medication. So there's an incredible difference between the task that we have delegated to this robot and the consequences that happen if something goes wrong in fulfilling this task, right? Or another example showing how the technology is really integrated into the patient-physician relationship. It's used as a tool to help communication or to facilitate communication between the patient and other care workers. Again, a machine-like appearance. And then another contrast, we see robots that are used, this is the huggable robot, that's used in pediatric wards for children who are nervous and stressed about the kinds of treatments that they might be undergoing or the tests that that they might be undergoing. So the robot reads the biometric signals and is able to adjust its behavior to help to calm down the child, right? So instead of thinking about a robot that's delivering something or that's reminding someone to take medications or helping us communicate, this is a robot that's tasked with actually trying to calm down a child in a situation. So there's no adult that's here in the situation. So this really had me questioning, you know, there's all different things that we want to use these robots for, but what are the limits? Is there a limit? Can we use robots for absolutely anything that our imagination, you know, can dream up and they can look in any way? Or should there actually be limits to what we're allowed to use the robot for? So this led me to develop this framework. So as I mentioned before, I was trying to bridge between ethics, design, and engineering. So the framework that I was developing is referred to as care-centered, value-sensitive design. So I was marrying the care ethics approach with this design approach known as value-sensitive design. And what I wanted to show is that there are limits and that we should be designing the robot in a way that pays tribute to the values in care, but also in a way that doesn't erode the patient-physician or the patient-caregiver relationship. So to give you an example of what a sort of analysis would look like, and I should emphasize that I'm just giving sort of the broad strokes of the sort of discussions that I was having. But if you want to know more information, you can of course read about it in articles and things like that. But just so you get a feel for what it was that I was trying to describe. So I take the example of lifting. Lifting in the hospital context or in a nursing home context. So if we can imagine what this scenario looks like, we see that nurses or porters would enter into a hospital room, talk to the patient. Hi, Mrs. Smith, how are you today? We're getting ready for your physiotherapy appointment, so I'm going to lift you now. Or it's time that we go to the bathroom for an examination, so I'm going to lift you now. They enclose the curtain around the patient, a manifestation of the value of privacy, right? Protecting the body from being visible to other people in the room or to other people passing the hallway. They speak to the patient in a certain way, and then they come over to the patient and actually lift the patient while they're making eye contact. They're attentive to different things that are going on with the patient. You know, if the patient winces because they've been pinched, they can adjust right away. They're there, they're present, they can engage. So there's all of these things that are happening. It's not just the mechanical practice of lifting, picking up, and putting the patient in their wheelchair or taking them to the toilet. I interviewed nurses and they would tell me about how when they are actually engaged in lifting, they're testing the neurological status of the patient. They're asking them questions, do you know what day it is? Do you know what time it is? Do you know who I am? They're testing the temperature, the skin of the patient's body. So there's a lot going on during this practice. Again, it's not just the mechanical lifting from one place to the other. But at the same time, this practice is also important for establishing the relationship, for establishing trusting bonds. And this is important for the overall care of the patient, right? When you have a relationship that's formed, the patient is more likely to comply with your care plan, take their medications, be honest about their symptoms. So there's this whole multi-layer, there's a ton of things that are happening during this practice. It's not just picking up and lifting and putting from one place to the other. But at the same time, we have to acknowledge that nurses are lifting patient after patient after patient, throwing their backs out, and they need some assistance. So there's a lot of different companies that are saying, well, let's make a robot to do this, right? It sounds like a great idea. So let's look at some different robot examples. This is the Reba robot. For a cute animal-like creature, sort of. The first generation of this robot was the Ryman, and it was a green robot. I don't know if anyone has seen pictures. A green robot with a mohawk. I don't know why they chose the mohawk, but they decided in favor of a more creature-like robot for the second generation. Anyway, this is an autonomous robot. So it comes into the hospital room and does the lifting completely autonomously. No human is involved, scoops up the patient and takes them and puts them into the wheelchair, or takes them from the wheelchair and puts them into the mechanical bed. So you can see here how there is, you know, none of the elements that I was talking about before. Of course, you could program the robot to speak in a certain way, to touch the skin, to test the neurological status. Those are, of course, things that you could program in. And you could also try and make it so that the robot is engaged in a relationship or forming a trusting bond. But then we have to ask, do we want the human to be trusting the robot? and then it complies with its care plan with the robot? Or would we rather that the robot is trusting the humans that are ultimately responsible and liable for the care that is being provided? So a very different scenario that's provided with this robot, and we can look at a different design of a robot, an exoskeleton, that fulfills, you know, an assistant or an assistive device to the care worker. The care worker wears this piece of apparatus, it reads the biometric signals, so the care worker doesn't actually have to feel the weight that they're lifting. They go and lift the patient, and they don't throw out their back in the meantime, right? And we can see that with a robot like this, we maintain all of those components and that richness that allowed us to understand the care practice as it was originally intended with the human care workers, the original scenario that I had described. So when we look at, you know, when we make comparisons like this, it really allows us to ultimately ask the question, what kind of care do we want to provide? What kind of patient-physician or patient-caregiver relationship do we want to establish in a hospital setting? And what's important to remember is what I didn't emphasize before, but this is context-dependent. So the framework also forces you to acknowledge what context we're in. And I started by talking about how this was a nursing home or a hospital setting. If we were in a home context, the analysis might change, right? In this context, it's incredibly important to establish this relationship, to make sure that we create trusting bonds and so on and so forth. But if we're in a home context, and we're talking about family members taking care of each other, this practice might not be necessary for establishing those same bonds. So it might be a more dignified form of care to provide the autonomous robot in a home context when we're not, you know, necessarily trying to build a relationship between caregiver and care receiver. So context is important, but ultimately what I wanted to do with the framework was to say there are limits to the kinds of roles that we should be delegating to robots. We can still have them in these morally and ethically salient or charged contexts, but we just have to make sure that we understand what is valuable and we don't create the robot in a way that erodes the values of care. But what's interesting is, and I thought that this was, you know, the conclusion that everyone would come to, right? Care context, this is what's important, don't screw with this, just make sure that the robot helps you facilitate and enhance this. But there's a whole body of research out there that has the complete opposite thinking to me, and that's machine ethics, right? And so machine ethics offers a different solution. So I wanted to explore why or how they come up with the solution. What are the reasons for justifying this very different approach? So as I said before, I'm doing machine ethics in 30 seconds. So for those of you who might know more about machine ethics, you know that I'm just giving, again, the broad strokes. But by the way, how is my speed? Is this too quick? No? And the volume is okay? Okay, it's actually great speaking in front of native English speakers because usually people tell me I'm way too fast, but this is awesome. Everyone's just with me, right? Okay, so machine ethics. The ultimate goal of machine ethics is to create autonomous ethical machines, right? And these are the mother and father, if you will, of machine ethics, Susan Leigh Anderson and Michael Anderson. And so the idea is that we're creating some sort of moral machine. This is actually a book written by Wendell Wallach and Colin Allen. Or James Moore talks about these machines that have ethical impact. They are ethical impact agents. And ultimately, the idea behind machine ethics, so creating these autonomous ethical agents or these autonomous ethical machines, is that the robot or the machine is capable of reasoning in an ethical way. And that means reasoning between competing conceptions of the good, understanding consequences of its actions, and being able to make a decision about what the best, the right, or the good choice would actually be. Interesting in this picture that you can see the robot is deciding between, you know, what the devil is telling it to do versus what the angel is telling it to do, and seems to be fixated on what the devil is telling it to do, right? Could that be, you know, a message to us that we have to be careful? Who knows? So if machine ethics is what kind of reasoning the robot, or can we endow robots with ethical reasoning capabilities, what are the arguments that are put forward in favor of this? So there's a range of different arguments, the first being inevitability, that these robots are going to be that, you know, in morally charged contexts no matter what, so we may as well give them moral reasoning capabilities. The second being that the robots are going to be so complex that we should give them ethical reasoning capabilities because we won't be able to predict what it is that they're going to actually do. Robots will be better moral reasoners than us. Humans are imperfect, but robots will be objective, impartial, and perfect, and therefore we should make them in this ethical reasoning way. Public acceptance will only accept the technology if it has these kinds of skills. Avoiding improper use, you know, you can't tell a robot to go and steal your neighbor's purse or your neighbor's car because the robot has some sort of ethical reasoning to tell it that that's the wrong thing to do. Another reason is better understanding of humans. So if we are forced to develop robots in this way, then we'll understand ourselves better. So now just sort of zooming in on some of these reasons, this is researcher Wendell Wallach, who is one of the authors of Moral Machines. And he's arguing from the perspective of inevitability. And he says, this is a quote from his book, "Robots with moral decision-making abilities will become a technological necessity." And so what's interesting here is he's really giving us this image that the robots are coming, right? And there isn't really much that we can do about it. And so because they're coming, we must give them, you know, capabilities that we think are necessary for them to have. It also conjures this image that humans and robots are almost sort of battling. You know, it's inevitable that they're going to come. The robots are going to win, and they're going to be here, right? So it's a really fascinating image that he's trying to conjure. But at the same time, he's making an assumption, too, that in order to harness the benefits of the robots, so it'll be a technological necessity because these robots are coming, in order for us to really be able to get the benefits of these robots, we ought to give them ethical reasoning capabilities. And I want to push back on this because it's almost like saying, because we have robots in healthcare, because they are in these ethically charged contexts, or these morally charged contexts, they're involved in performing surgery, then this robot should either be autonomous and or should have ethical reasoning capabilities. So we jump quickly to the robot actually performing the surgery, right? Or the robot making decisions about the surgery, being able to override the decision of the surgeon. So let's say the surgeon is in the middle of performing and this robot who is in the ethically charged context has these ethical reasoning capabilities, makes, you know, some quick calculation saying that, the movement that the surgeon wants to do I don't think is going to be beneficial for the patient, so boom, blocks the movement of the surgeon. So the robot has much more control and power in the surgery. So do we want to make that assumption that just because the robot is in the context, it ought to have these capabilities? Or looking at another example, robots in humanitarian contexts. This is an example of a robot that is not autonomous, that doesn't require ethical reasoning capabilities in order to harness the power of what it can provide in this context. This is a human-operated robot that the human operator is able to see where someone is in need and can drop assistance until someone can reach them and provide further or greater assistance. So the idea that even though it's inevitable that these robots will be in these contexts, this is of course a morally charged context, but that is not a necessary and sufficient condition to say that it also ought to have ethical reasoning capabilities. So another author that tries to make an argument along the same lines is Matthias Schütz. And he just recently in 2016 wrote the paper, "The Need for Moral Competency in Autonomous Agent Architectures." And what he says, so he has a little bit of a, he takes a little bit of a different stance on the inevitability, but still sort of asserting this idea that it's inevitable these robots will be in these contexts and will be faced with ethical situations and therefore should have ethical reasoning capabilities. He says, "Any ordinary decision-making situation from daily life can be turned into a morally charged decision-making situation where the artificial agent finds itself presented with a moral dilemma, where any choice of action or inaction could potentially cause harm to other agents. The only way to minimize human harm is to build morally competent robots that can detect and resolve morally charged situations in human-like ways." There's a lot packed into those statements, right? But I wanted to push back on two different parts of the statement. He's talking about human harm and avoiding human harm. And we have to be careful that we don't reduce the idea of ethics to one of safety and security or of human harm. And of course, I mean, I'm the first one to acknowledge that this is an important part of ethics and an ethical discussion. I'm not standing here arguing that it's okay if robots harm humans, that's no big deal. Harm or prevention of harm to humans is an important conversation and component of ethical robots or building robots that are acceptable. But ethics is about much more than just the harm to human, the physical harm to human. And so if he's talking about making safe robots, then this is a different conversation. This is safe robots. This isn't morally competent robots, right? So I wanted to just push back on that and say that he needs to be careful about his semantics, about the words that he's actually saying. But in addition, I want to challenge other sort of assumptions that are built into his line of reasoning. And we can say, yes, there are situations that might, you know, seem to be ordinary situations. We can imagine a robot patrolling in the hallway and nothing really goes wrong, and then, oh my gosh, you have a child who's fallen and the robot is in some sort of, you know, situation where does it pick up the child? Does it not pick up the child? Does it help it? Does it not? How does it make these decisions? And we can leap to assume that the robot should provide assistance, right, from a duties perspective or a consequences perspective. But isn't the more interesting question, why have we put the robot there in the first place? So if we decide that the robot could be in an ethically charged situation, why are we putting it there in the first place, where it could be confronted with these kinds of decisions? Is it really that necessary to have a robot in this kind of context where it's patrolling halls or where it could be confronted with, do I pick up this child? Do I not pick up this child? Or also, you know, thinking about what Matthias Schutz says, any ordinary daily decision-making activity could be turned into a morally charged context. So, I mean, what does this mean that, you know, really anything that we're doing could be turned into something that's morally charged, even something like the robot who's around our house to water plants and take care of things? Or is he really referring to a robot that interacts with a human so that there's a physical dimension to it? And if that's the case, then we've wiped out robots that communicate with other robots, right? So imagine that this robot who isn't interacting with any other robot still has a lot of data about what's going on in the house, can communicate that with other robots, which have access to this information that could be harmful, could be used for discrimination, could be used for advertising or big data purposes and whatnot. So are we talking about just physical harm? Does the robot have to be actually physically present, or could it be just robot having access to data? And if it's just about the robot having access to data, then any robot that is able to communicate with any other robot then becomes one of these potentially harmful robots. So then this really stretches the idea, it stretches the borders of what he's talking about, you know, when we would need robots that have ethical reasoning capabilities. Now, every robot that can communicate with another robot needs to have ethical reasoning capabilities because we need to protect data ownership or data issues. And another example, just to point out, you know, really, how far should we go with this idea that any context or any situation can be turned into a morally charged one? And so, continuing to push back a little bit, I also wanted to highlight a distinction that needs to be made between being in an ethically charged context and being delegated an ethical role. So imagine, you know, we're in a nursing care facility or a healthcare institute, something like that, and we have a robotic pet that's there to sort of, you know, brighten the spirits or just entertain or maybe help with getting the patients physical and getting them active. And you know, this is a robot dog that would be used in place of a real dog because the institute might not be able to provide care for a real dog, right? But would we, and so this is a robot in an ethically charged situation or context, right, so to speak. But if we had a real dog that was there to provide entertainment or to provide certain physiological benefits, would we assume that the dog had to have some sort of ethical reasoning capabilities because the dog is now a part of this practice, is a part of this context? So it seems like a leap is being made. What is so special about the robots? Why do we assume that if they're going to be in these contexts, if we're going to delegate them these roles, then they must also have ethical reasoning capabilities to go along with what we've delegated them. So moving away now, that was the inevitability argument. The robots are coming, it's inevitable that they're going to be in these situations, and therefore they ought to have ethical reasoning capabilities. Now looking at another argument that's being made, and that's from the perspective of complexity. So the decisions that the robots will be making will be so complex, machine learning, that the robot will actually be making decisions that couldn't be foreseen or programmed by the actual programmer. So the complexity of the decisions is increasing. So James Moores is a scholar that argues from the perspective of complexity, we need to have robots that have ethical reasoning capabilities. And what he says is, again another quote, because machines are becoming more sophisticated and make our lives more enjoyable, future machines will likely have increased control and autonomy to do this. More powerful machines need more powerful ethics. So it's a really interesting idea. I mean, you know, it makes sense at face value, but what is this more powerful machine, or what is this more complex machine, right? Because we can see that there's a lot of complexity that goes into the kinds of things that you and I do that we just have no idea, right? It's very difficult to program robots to act in the unpredictable environment that we're used to acting in. But also something like getting a robot to play a violin or to engage in that kind of practice. I mean, this is incredibly complex. And so, of course, this is not the type of complexity that James Moore was talking about. But I want to push back and say, well, give us more. What are you talking about when you say complex? Is it about movement and interacting? Because again, RoboCup is another example of the complexity to program the robot, to interact with other robots, to communicate with them, to actually kick the ball. It's taken years to get the robots to actually kick a ball. But just because the robot is, and of course not in an ethically charged complex, but due to the complexity of the architecture, should this robot have some sort of ethical reasoning capabilities? What is the limits, right? What exactly? But this is the robot dog, Robo Dog, by Boston Dynamic. The complexity of this machine required to not only carry heavy materials, but to maneuver between sand and water, that's incredible what this robot is actually doing. But is this a necessary and sufficient condition for saying that the robot ought to have some sort of ethical reasoning capabilities? Of course we would say no. But then we demand more to tell us more about his complexity. So another reason that I had on the list was that robots would be better moral reasoners. So the idea here is we make a robot, we endow it with ethical reasoning capabilities because it will be better than humans. So it can teach us how to be better, right? Which is great. Of course, we all want that, right? A robot telling us how bad we are and how we can be better. And so James Gibbs, who writes Towards the Ethical Robot, he says, not many human beings live their lives flawlessly as moral saints, but a robot could. Yeah? Or another argument in the same line, this is Eric Dietrich, who's also arguing that robots will be better moral reasoners than humans. He says, humans are genetically hardwired to be immoral. And let us, the humans, exit the stage, leaving behind a planet populated with machines who, although not perfect angels, will nevertheless be a vast improvement over us. It's a really interesting idea that we will program the robots and they will become better than us. Now, something that we're missing out on, I mean, it's a really fascinating idea, but what we're forgetting is a couple of things. And are you familiar with Tay, the chatbot, the Microsoft chatbot, the racist chatbot, if I describe it that way? So we're forgetting about the idea or the problem of inherent bias when we consider the idea that the robot will be a better moral reasoner than us. What data are we going to use to educate the robot? Yeah?
There was another robot that was tested in Japan.
Yeah.
For like this, so say sister to Tay. Instead of becoming a racist, this Japanese person became a complete nerd. Like it would start making pop culture references.
Right.
Right.
And so no slight on Japan whatsoever, but it's almost a fascinating cultural experiment, right?
Exactly.
The kinds of people that are interested.
We made Tay that way. They chose to make her a different way.
Right, exactly, exactly. So beautiful example. Thank you for that. So for those of you who don't know Tay, or don't know about Tay, I say that like Tay is a person, but for those of you who don't know about Tay, this was a Twitter chatbot, a Twitter AI chatbot, as they refer to it. And so it was launched publicly, and the idea was that Tay would develop a personality, and I use, you know, air quotations for personality because we can debate about whether or not Tay was developing a personality, but Tay was developing a personality based on the kinds of conversations that it would have with people who were sending it tweets. So it was learning how to be something by what people were telling it. Yeah, so this is essentially what underpins big data and machine learning. And so this was, you know, public knowledge, and the kinds of people, I don't want to say kinds, but the kinds of things that the people were doing to teach Tay how to develop a personality, they were sending Tay messages that were misogynistic, racist, discriminatory. So then when you had a conversation with Tay, Tay would reflect this misogynistic, racist, discriminatory, terrible things that Tay was actually saying, terrible things that Tay was actually saying. And so Microsoft actually took Tay off, what was like 24 hours after it had been released, because it was just incredible how evil, almost, the things that Tay were saying. So the personality that Tay developed, what Tay learned, was about what was being taught, right? So this is trying to get at the idea that we will be teaching the robots. And so the assumption that the robot will be a better moral reasoner is really kind of a leap. How is it exactly going to learn to be this better moral reasoner? Not only that, but who is going to decide that it's a better moral reasoner? Right? So if, let's say it was a different example with Tay, right? Let's say that Tay is learning everything that we're talking about and then comes back and says, okay, I've decided, based on everything that I know now, it's time that we take care of climate control issues. It's time that we seriously invest in environmental protection, right? So how are we going to decide that, yeah, this is the ethical thing to do, and we should be doing exactly what the computer or exactly what the robot has told us to do? So it's one thing to make the leap that the robot is going to be a better moral reasoner. It's another thing to say, who is going to decide that the robot is a better moral reasoner? Under what rubric? How do we evaluate that the robot has come to a better decision than we ever could? And are we going to listen? So what is the benefit of creating this technology if the robot is telling us you really have to clean up this, you really have to look at underrepresented populations, you really have to look at this and that and the other, and are we ultimately going to pay attention? What is the benefit of having this technology if we just sort of say, oh, that's nice, oh, great, wow, the robot is better than us. Okay, back to daily living now. So the last point that I wanted to touch on was this idea that robots will give us a better understanding of morality. So really here, this is again James Gibbs, same paper, talking about Towards the Ethical Robot, and he says, the hope with making robots in this way is that we try to implement ethical systems on the computer, and in so doing, we learn much more about the knowledge and the assumptions built into the ethical theories themselves. That as we build the artificial ethical reasoning systems, we will learn how to behave more ethically ourselves. So a really nice utopian picture here, right? We'll learn not only about the flaws that we have in our ethical theories or in our own ethical reasoning, but in so doing, in learning about these flaws, we will become better moral reasoners ourselves. So even if we go back to the Tay example, do you think that the individuals, you know, in learning about what their behavior did, that they will become better ethical moral reasoners themselves? That's quite a leap to think about. But ultimately, I don't have too much pushback for this argument. I think this is a really fascinating idea. Already you can see, when we're talking about robot ethics, when we're talking about machine ethics, the conversations that we have to have in order to understand what is an ethical agent, right? Is an ethical agent something that must be sentient, that has consciousness, that can feel pleasure and pain? How would we make a robot actually become a kind of ethical agent? It's really, you know, it's been quite an exciting time in the ethics world or in the robot ethics world, because it's forcing us to sort of come back to justifications for beliefs that we have. Now we have to reopen them and think again. So I agree that making robots and endowing them with ethical reasoning capabilities will give us a better understanding of morality. But I still would push back and say, there's a difference between doing fundamental research, right? There's a difference between exploring or understanding biochemical or biological warfare in the lab and knowing what's happening and using it out in the wild in a context. And that's a drastic example. I don't mean to make a simile between ethical robots and biological warfare, but I just mean to sort of conjure an image that just because we can justify doing this kind of research for understanding does not necessarily mean that we should be employing it or deploying it in the wild without having empirical studies that show us the consequences of interacting with these robots. So some other general issues to think about, really, the one that sort of spans over all of the reasons that were given by these researchers is the ultimate question, what is good? Right? And this is something that ethicists don't agree, philosophers don't agree. Nobody can agree on a particular conception of what is good, but also how do we arrive at what is good? So we have different ethical theories, the duties approach or the consequentialist approach. No one can agree on really which theory is the ultimate in telling us how we can arrive at good. So how can we really assume that a robot is going to be able to arrive at this conclusion of good when we can't agree with it? And not only that, but that's also part of the beauty of ethics, that we get to evolve with our thinking, that we get to push back against each other, that we get to have discussions about competing conceptions of the good, and they don't become standards right now, right? They don't become embedded in the system. We get to have conversations and decide on our policies and regulations that will guide our behavior. But really, if we look at some different ideas or images of what different cultures consider to be good, right? These are Japanese robots in French-made costumes to provide entertainment. This is a fun, good thing, right, that other individuals might be exposed to. Or consider if it was the developers in Saudi Arabia that got to determine what was good and how they would program an ethical robot. What would that look like for our culture? Should this be something that's decided between one culture and another? Or a hot topic that we've had over the last couple of days. This is a maker in Japan who makes a line of robots. He's what's the word I'm looking for? Not a closeted, but he's an open. He's open about the fact that he's a pedophile. And so in order for him to not act out or harm any human children with his fantasies, he's created a line of robotic dolls that help him satisfy his desires and his needs. Right? So he considers this a good thing. Right? And do other cultures. There's a case going on right now in Canada, where Canadian, in the legal system, they're trying to decide, is this the kind of thing that we want to promote as being good, or at least permissible? Perhaps good is a stretch. So who is going to decide the good that we embed into the robot to make the robot this ethical agent? How are we going to decide this? Is this going to be up to each different culture or country, and they get to come up, you know, with their idea of what the ethical robot is, and then we just sort of, you know, decide amongst the resulting robots which one we like and which one we will use on sort of a global scale. So a lot of things, yeah, how's everyone doing? That's a lot of things that I'm pushing at you, right? There's a quiz in about 10 minutes, so get out your paper. But really, what I also want to stress here is that, you know, there's so much happening and there's so many reasons going back and forth for why we should make robots, right? Autonomous vehicles is a classic case right now. Everyone keeps referring to the trolley problem, that the autonomous car is going to be in this situation. Does it kill one person or multiple people? Is there a difference if the one person is the passenger and the multiple people are children that it's come across, or is it just a numbers game? And so there's a lot of talk about how, you know, in order to make sure that the robotic car makes the right decision, it should have some sort of ethical reasoning capability. So it's a really hot topic right now. Elon Musk, a year ago, just donated 10 million euro, or $10 million, sorry, to a company making quote-unquote good AI, or exploring whether or not they could make good AI. A lot of the big companies are trying to do this. The Future of Life Institute over in the UK is exploring this idea of whether or not we can make AI good. So there's a lot of money, a lot of resources that are being directed towards this question, towards finding a solution to this question of whether or not robots should and can have these ethical reasoning capabilities. Well, what I want to sort of encourage us to reflect on is what happens when we get there, right? So let's say, okay, let's sweep everything under the rug. We agree on the theory that we're going to use. We all agree on what the good robot does, what it looks like, how it arrives at its decision. Then what do we do, right? What is the moral status of the robot? Is it a part of our moral community? Is it like a child, you know, that we need to sort of take care of and give some sort of rights and freedoms and liberty to? What is the legal status of the robot? So is it something that we own, right? Is it your property? Or is it this sort of pseudo-human that, of course, you can't own, but you take care of it and you rear it as it lives in your home or as it works in your company? Assignment of roles and responsibilities. So if these robots have these capabilities, who and how do we assign what they're going to do? Is it wrong for us to make these robots, you know, do search and rescue or act in military contexts because they have capabilities that you and I have? And we don't want to do these jobs. That's why we're making the robots in the first place. But if they have these kinds of capabilities, does it then become wrong or at least morally problematic for us to make them do these kinds of things that we're envisioning in the first place? And liability issues. Because the robot has this sort of moral agency or perhaps a sense of moral responsibility, does that also mean that we make the robot liable? We sue the robot? We blame the robot? We fire the robot? And how exactly do we do that? How do we punish the robot? We power it down, we turn it off? Or do we have to make it sort of feel pain so that it understands when it's done something wrong? And then there's a whole set of questions towards that, right? We've talked about that in the last couple of days. Is there something fundamentally or ultimately wrong with trying to make some other entity feel torture and feel pain? Okay, so last two slides. Are you still with me? We can do this. So the main questions that I wanted to leave you with, really, and again, on this topic of should we be making robots that can think in this way, what kind of control do we want to delegate to our machines? So this is a question that we have to ask before we decide to give the robot these capabilities. Once we see, you know, when they have these capabilities, they can do different things. We will want them to do different things. We will want them to take care of our children. We will want them to make life and death decisions in triage situations. So is this the place that we want to get to? Is this the kind of control and responsibility that we want to give to these machines? And who is deciding what capabilities a robot ought to have? Is this something that we think companies should ultimately be responsible for deciding, or is it the users, the people who are going to be using the technology in the future? And really, this goes back to a question that's come up multiple times in the last couple of days at the different talks about the displacement of jobs and the displacement or the impact on the labor market. And we need to decide what roles and jobs do we as a society want to delegate to robots? And this is a really important question, because if we want to give robots these capabilities to reason in an ethical way, we will be more inclined to give them jobs that require these capabilities. And right now we see that the kinds of jobs that we're predicting will be replaced by robots are the repetitive jobs, the ones that don't require too much interpersonal interaction or communication. So teachers, for example, aren't going to be ultimately displaced by robots. But if we start making robots in this way, where they can reason, you know, in this way, will we be more inclined to delegate that kind of a job to a robot? And is there something wrong with that? Are we okay with that, right? Or is our intuition telling us something different? So your takeaway message is, it's not about including ethical reasoning into the robot so much. It's really about deciding the place that the robot ought to have in our lives. And what I was hoping to do in the last 50 minutes was really to shift the burden of proof. So I wanted to show that the machine ethicists are giving these sort of Yeah, superficial, but I mean that in the politest of ways, looking at the camera for when this is on the internet. So they're giving sort of superficial reasons for why we might, you know, endow robots with ethical reasoning capabilities. And I want to shift the burden of proof. It's not necessarily up to the ethicist to say, careful. It ought to be about the machine ethicist really coming back with reasons that show, that ultimately prove the necessity and the sufficiency of why we need to have robots with these capabilities, and why we don't need to worry about the moral status or the legal status or the delegation of very sensitive roles and jobs to these robots. So, thank you very much for your time and for being here, and I'm happy to take any questions that you have.
Okay, so thanks very much. I'll just open the floor up for some questions. Chris.
So thanks for the talk. So I was interested in the sort of complexity argument that you started with, and I thought the dog analogy was useful because we think of dogs as facing complex decisions that have moral dimensions, but we don't think of them as moral agents. And so I think there's a way in which you can ask, what is it that makes a decision maker a moral agent, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's all kinds of cases where it just seems like even though there's a complex decision being made, we don't apply moral aspects to it. So even cases like if a student makes a mistake on an exam, you don't say liar, right? That just seems like the wrong kind of category.
Right.
So the question is, for robots, even if they're facing complex decisions, I mean, isn't there some element of intentionality or autonomy that you have to attribute to them? And so the people making the complexity arguments, are they saying that they're not just facing complex decisions, but there's some element of autonomy you can attribute to them?
Right, so absolutely they say that there is. The reason why it becomes so complex is because there is this element of autonomy. Intentionality is so problematic, though, because it's still argued that the robot never has any sense or degree of intentionality. It's always the programmer who has given them a sense of intentionality. They know what their task is. They might find a variety of ways to get there, which is their autonomy. They are allowed to do that, but the intentionality is directed from the programmer.
Right, but you might worry that that's not an autonomy that's sufficient for thinking of them as moral agents.
Right, exactly. I would absolutely argue that that is not an autonomy that is sufficient.
Right.
And that's something that I have a problem with. That I get the feeling that the machine ethicists are arguing that that is an autonomy that renders them sufficient for having ethical reasoning capabilities. Yeah.
Okay. Craig?
So what I'm finding so interesting is this idea of, I mean, you know, thinking of robots as having a sort of ethical values or a sort of moral nature. We're trying to think of them in terms of a human ethic. And I can't even imagine what a robot ethic really would be because it's just a different, you know, when they get a sufficient level of autonomy, it'll be a different life form, and it's hard for me to get my head around, you know, why I think that they would need to be this way. Maybe they'll have a totally different.
Right. No, that's a really great point, and that was something that I wanted to hit on when I was talking about the researcher Matthias Schutz, who was talking about harm. And I think that we need to, and it's a really sexy idea to talk about the ethical robot. That is actually, you know, the title of papers, the ethical robot. But really, ethics, I mean, especially if you're a virtue ethicist, which I think is, yeah, and you talk about ethics over a lifespan, decision-making over a lifespan, and being directed and learning from your mistakes and directing yourself towards being this ultimate individual. And is that really what we mean by the robot, that it's going to be learning and directed towards that? Or do we mean that the robot will be safe to interact with and will make decisions based on a pre-programmed subroutine that allows it to make the safe choice? And I think we mean that the robot's going to be safe to interact with, that we should, you know, that there's some sort of guarantee that it's reliably safe as well, too, that we can somewhat predict, but I guess with machine learning we can't. But I like this idea that the ethical robot is not the ethical human. And so we should come up with either a different language to speak about it, or just stop saying ethical robots, stop saying moral machines, and say safe machines, reliable machines that we can interact with.
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, if you ask, what is a good life for a robot?
Exactly. Yeah. And I didn't want to get into, yesterday I did, you know, what is ethics? I'm talking about the good life. And I didn't get into that today. But really, ethics, I mean, it's so much more robust than the way that it's discussed. You know, you have to reduce ethics to this small program code, in order to have it embedded in the robot. And is that really, don't we want to maintain the robustness of ethics, you know, in order to give credit, to give it its due credit? But great point. Let's come up with a new language for it.
Thank you. Speaking as an engineer, maybe this is a little bit missing some points here. Now, suppose you have built a level of ethics into a robotic system or a robot. Now, you built also into the robot mechanism to learn, machine learning. So obviously, this is going to mean that this ethical behavior is going to change as the robot experiences different circumstances. So how are you going to ensure that the persons or the people that the robot comes in contact with are the right sort of people that do not change the ethics to something like the Japanese racist robot? Yeah.
The Japanese robot wasn't racist. We should probably, for the record, clarify that. It was the American Microsoft robot that was racist. Yeah, that's a brilliant question. That's a brilliant question, really. How can we, and I think that speaks to the second dimension of robot ethics. You know, should there be a sort of code of users? So when you are interacting with a robot, you have to behave in a certain way in order to ensure that you don't really screw up the architecture or the learning of the robot. But I think what's remarkable about your point is that it speaks to humans and what we want to do, what we think is sort of fun to do, and how that could ultimately shape, you know, the direction of the robots. And then that makes us question, will the robots in fact be better moral reasoners? If we're trying to get them to do things that maybe aren't good things to do, and will it give us a better understanding of morality, or will it just give us a better understanding of juvenile or delinquent behavior? But I really like that point about. Should we even control? Should we try and control how humans interact with the robot, or should the robot have to sort of? Sort of blank out, like the robot has to have a sense that what you've just told it is racist, and so it won't take that into its learning. It's a really interesting point.
Yeah.
When I was in high school, I did a similar presentation on the ethics of robots.
Sorry, you did a what presentation?
A similar presentation.
Oh, okay.
And afterwards, the teacher in front of me with a philosophical question, namely the trolley problem.
Yeah.
And she put it in I was arguing for automated cars, and she argued, well, what if I had the choice between either hurting the driver or hurting the kid? And I didn't know about the trolley problem at hand, so I didn't know how to solve it. I couldn't have an answer. I only realized later that there is no answer. But it's something it seemed like current news, like, for example, the Tesla accident for that person.
The one where the man was watching Harry Potter?
Yeah.
That one, yeah.
Like, I've noticed that there's this mentality among many people that they will not accept self-driving cars unless they are absolutely 100% better drivers than the other ones. And that leads into my question. Like, my teacher confronted me with that question, that unsolvable problem, but now I realize I think she wanted the AI to actually be able to solve that problem.
Mm.
I think what do you think that, like, we seem to have this mentality that AIs should even be able to solve the moral dilemmas that even we can't solve. Is that expecting too much of them?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that is expecting too much, but I think it's a really, interesting wish that we have for the AI to be able to do that, to solve all of these unsolvable issues or questions. But the interesting thing about the trolley problem, we were talking about this too the other day, is that I think you mentioned a statistic that if everyone was in autonomous cars, the number of car fatalities would drop, would drop significantly, right? And of course, I mean, that's a great argument. All right, sure, let's all drive autonomous cars. And then I come back with, who's going to be driving the autonomous cars, right? We're going to have this blend of some people in autonomous cars, some people not in autonomous cars. How do they know how to interact with each other? Who's going to afford the autonomous cars? So I think there's so many issues that go beyond the trolley problem. It's become a nice sort of smokescreen for issues of distributive justice. Who's going to have access to the technology? So it's really, yeah, really an interesting question.
I thought that the arguments for inevitability and complexity, which maybe we won't have good ethical robots out of them, but I thought they were strong in the sense that, to me, it does seem somewhat inevitable or complex, because if you didn't want this to happen, how would you go about stopping it? Like, if you were to legislate people can't write machine learning code, well, you would lose all of the benefits from that. But if the machine's learning itself, how would you know what it's going to learn, what direction it's going to take?
Yeah, and so, I mean, I think that's a really great point, and it's really difficult to argue against that. So I'm gonna go back to, especially this inevitability idea, right? That it's inevitable that the robots are going to be in healthcare. Okay.
Even if, what I mean though is, let's say, even if people don't want this, if some mad scientist proverbially creates it, how would you go about stopping or making it illegal? Like, I don't even know exactly what you would make illegal, say.
Sex robots that are personified as children. We're in the process of deciding if we want that to be considered illegal. Yeah, absolutely. And yes, a mad scientist over in Japan has made a whole line of these. So you're right, actually. We are in an interesting time right now where we have to decide how we want this technology to fit into our idea of what we want, how we want society to actually function. And so right now we are making policy, we are making legislation to determine when is a robot allowed to look a certain way or to do certain things. So there isn't anything decided, but it's up to the public sort of enforce on policymakers and say, no, absolutely, this is not where we want to go. Or the public sort of sits back and does nothing. And you're right, it'll be up to companies, not necessarily the mad scientists.
I don't mean
yeah,
mad scientists,
but the companies.
Yeah,
it's absolutely, there's a push from companies. But what I wanted to show with this example was that I think it's possible, like the unemployment conversation is really, it's a hot topic right now. Everyone is afraid that robots are going to be taking their jobs. And so I wanted to show that there's a way for companies still to make a ton of money, still to have their really cool robots, but to just think differently about design. So think differently about a robot that can do the same thing. We're talking about lifting. And in one case, you fire a whole bunch of people and you introduce a fleet of robots. In another case, you maintain a whole bunch of jobs, but you still have the benefits of introducing the technology into the scenario. So if you can show a company that they can still make their cool technology, they can still make a ton of money by doing it, but at the same time, you can protect the welfare of the state and you can also maintain, some of the values of an institute or of a practice, I think that's what's beautiful right now, is that we can actually show how ethics can help, can point towards, can steer the good of the technology.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you, and you don't have to answer this because I've been talking for a long time. How do you decide what a robot can learn if you don't know what they're going to? But anyway.
How would who? So when you say I, like
who,
me? Like,
well, I don't know. Me? Society, perhaps. Yes. It seems like they would have to do this through laws. And how do you legislate what a robot could learn if you don't necessarily know where that's going?
So laws is the last step. It's going to be a long time before we have laws. I was just hearing the other day about we just have laws for fax machines. Is that what? Yeah. So the laws of the standards. We just have standards for fax machines now. Who uses a fax machine anymore, right? So it's going to be a while before we have standards and before we have laws that are regulating robots. But it's in the near future that we will have policies that guide best practices, yeah, or, you know, that will have regulations that tell companies what they can and can't do. And for that, yeah, I mean, it might be a bit of a utopian picture that I have, but I do think there is a powerful voice in the people to put pressure, to join, you know, groups that try to raise awareness. I just realized I didn't talk about, so I am an assistant professor at the university, but I'm also co-director of the Foundation for Responsible Robotics. And we are a group of academics that work together with industry and work together with policymakers to try and raise awareness about issues that are, or sectors that are in need of policy to try and push the United Nations to make codes of conduct and best practices. So it is possible for us to have a voice and to try and, you know, put pressure on the kinds of robots that we want, or at least, you know, the kinds of codes of ethics that companies have to abide by. So environmental standards, or, you know, you can't make AI to do this kind of thing, but it's a really tough question. No.
Last question.
Yeah.
So
no.
To what extent is the question to do with what kind of ethics we would program a robot to have different from the question of what type of ethics you would program your child to have?
Oh, wow.
So who decides that? Well, you get discretion to decide that, and probably most people in this room who have children will get the discretion to decide that. So
yeah.
How different or similar are the questions? I mean, we do give people liberty to do that.
Yeah.
We do have different disagreements about those kinds of things.
Yeah, I think where there is a difference is the fact that it's a company that's making a decision about the kinds of ethics the robot will have. And when the bottom line is money, when economics is the bottom line, your ethics is probably going to be somewhat different, would be my guess. But you're right, it is very similar. And you can imagine that we may be in a scenario one day where people who buy a robot that becomes a member of the family or a part of the home are allowed to determine the kind of ethics or the kind of behavior they want the robot to have. And so they think it's okay if the robot is, you know, protecting the outskirts of their property, and if a dog comes to try and do a number two on their yard, the robot can go over and kick the dog or something. I mean, who knows, right? Who knows what kind of ethics we'll want to have in the robots. But yeah, it's a really good question. Is it different from children? Yeah.
Justin?
Well, even if safety is the bottom line, not money, it seems like there's still a whole bunch of problems that sort of go back to the trolley problem.
The trolley problem.
Yeah, right. So the crux of the trolley problem is that it's psychopathic to count bodies instead of taking account of people. Right?
Yeah.
But if really we just want safe robots, as you said, that's the sort of end game.
Yeah.
And psychopathic robots save the most people by making utilitarian decisions, then really we want psychopathic robots.
Right.
Right?
That's a pretty scary idea, but yeah, you're right. Yeah. So this will be the new language that we were talking about. Instead of the ethical robot, the psychopathic robot. Okay, trademark.
There are better ways to put that.
Yeah.
Okay. That's kind of, just in behind there, yeah.
So I think from your slides and from how you kind of describe ethical robots and their purpose in like a work environment, you have this concept that robots are like human-like almost.
Appearance or?
I don't know. Like I'm kind of interested to see, like to hear what your understanding of a robot is, because like a conveyor belt that takes food from the kitchen to someone's table is a robot, and it costs little to nothing to implement. And before anyone has thought about ethics, they've already implemented it, and like all these Bader's jobs are gone.
Right.
So, what do you think?
What is a robot?
What is a robot? Why even to discuss? I mean, I feel like discussing the ethics of robots is a very high level and very, very expensive scenario.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So I think the more need application of robots, I think, doesn't require so much the ethics of like the actual robots, but the designers that choose to implement them.
Right. And so that's what I meant. So at the very beginning, I was talking about robot ethics, and there are these three dimensions to robot ethics. And so yesterday I was talking about the other dimensions. So the questions that you just raised have to do with the first dimension of robot ethics. And today I was intentionally focusing on this third dimension about the robot as the ethical agent. But you're absolutely right that this is one part of the conversation, and that the first two are incredibly important parts of the conversation that need to be had. And my own personal belief is that I think we're, you know, jumping the gun by investing. That's also why I raised the fact that millions of dollars are being invested into making robots of this kind without us being able to address the conveyor belt robot that has displaced so many workers. So I think those questions are really incredibly important. But you want to know what a robot is, or what I'm thinking of a robot. So we had this question on the panel, and I gave the definition of the word robot, right, that it comes from Rawson's Universal Robot, the play in 1920, means slave or servant to human. And before that, we had automata, and Isaac Asimov, of course, coined robotics, which is the study of robots at large, and robot is just sort of one robot. But the technology, or the technological definition, I was also trying to point out that the word or the concept robot is a socially constructed concept. It means something different depending on what stage of development we're in. So sort of adhering to this idea of interpretive flexibility, robot means something right now to us, but in 2 and 5 years from now, it could mean something different, which makes it really hard to sort of pinpoint what it is. But essentially, it's a system, a machine, that can perceive, think, and act. And on top of that, it needs to be embodied. So it's not just a smart home technology, but it needs to be embodied in the world and can act on the world. So it perceives, it takes information in from its environment, it thinks about the information. I don't like the word think, yeah, but it processes the information and then it acts out on its environment. Did that answer your question? Yeah. But I mean, like, you're preaching to the choir when you say, why aren't we addressing these issues of unemployment, or about something like a conveyor belt coming into the scene and displacing all of these workers? And that's really, you know, I'm very passionate about that. But today I was really trying to focus on, you know, this, why are we making robots in this way in the first place, or why do we want to? Yeah, so, and I couldn't agree with you more. This is also part of the debate. This is why I was sort of questioning in this conversation, are we reducing ethics to something that isn't really ethics anymore? It's just a conversation about safety and security and reliability of interacting with the system. But I love this idea, you're right. In order to be an ethical agent, you must have a sense, or you should have a sense of moral responsibility. And then what happens, you know, if we try and endow that in the robot, then is it okay for us to make the robot, you know, clean up after us and be in the military and do these kinds of things? And you can even go further, right? So a sense of moral responsibility or self-awareness is one thing, but should we also, in order for the robot to fully understand the consequences of its actions, if it could harm someone, the robot should understand what harm is like. The robot should have a concept of what death means. So how are we going to torture the robot to the point where it really can grasp the consequences of its actions? So that's why I think it's problematic calling them ethical robots, that we should have the psychopathic robot. Yeah. But great point, thanks.
Thanks for this material. So without being a specialist, I have a sense of
arguably, real life is way too complicated to be able to capture a programmer.
For sure.
So we're talking about programming machines that will be able to make rational decisions or moral decisions. But I have the sense that, real life is so complicated that we cannot really realistically program a computer that it will be able to cope with any unforeseen situations. So if we go for a deterministic machine, then I guess most of the time the machine will be like useless. It will not know how to react in all
right.
these situations.
Right.
But then if we go, which sounds more realistic, for a non-deterministic machine, a non-deterministic algorithm or randomized algorithms, then things I'm afraid will be soon will get unpredictable and unsafe for us maybe. And I think that's a concern that was also captured by expressed by Stephen Hawking and Peter Singer, the both wrote that artificial intelligence
will end
likely,
humanity.
Yeah, most likely will be against will turn against us. So how do we
Yeah, so I think Stephen Hawking was also referring more to like the Kurzweil singularity dimension to artificial intelligence, one that we probably won't see in our lifetime, that humanity is going to be ended, or we do, and then that's it for us, right? But I think, and so I'm fascinated and I'm struggling with this idea, right? We're going to make these machines that are so complex and that become unpredictable. And okay, I guess I can understand that, but at the same time, what's wrong? I mean, what's wrong with a machine like this that is predictable in so far as it has object avoidance? It can stop if you're getting closer. It can move out of the way from you. It's still a very powerful machine. It can help us do things. So why is it that we need to make the machines that are so complex that they become unpredictable? Are they really providing so much of a benefit? So to answer your question, I would ask a question that goes, before it. I would argue and push back that I haven't seen proof that it is so necessary that we must have these machines that are so complex that we can't predict what their actions are going to be anymore. And then we get into the Stephen Hawking, AI will want to end us because we are bad people and so on and so forth. So I answer your question with a question.
But wouldn't that be then?
Because we can predict what this robot is going to do, but that doesn't make it any less valuable.
Yeah, but can this robot make decisions in complex situations, not very simple deterministic situations, but when things get just a little bit more complex, the robot just gets stuck.
It would stop. Yeah, it would stop and wait for, I mean, it has path planning, so it knows where it's going within the hospital, but it would stop and wait for the person to, so, okay, let's say an example is that someone comes really close to the robot and so is blocking its sensors, the robot has to stop and enact, and it's, shaking the robot or kicking the robot or something. This is a situation that it's not programmed for. Why would we want it to do anything, right? What's wrong with just the robot stopping and not moving until the person has gotten out of the way, and then the robot goes again? For it to be unpredictable, the robot could veer to the one side and veer to the other side and then set off an alarm in the hospital, but yeah, I guess I don't see the utility.
I guess we want more powerful machines.
Want more powerful machines, right. And that's what I'm trying to push back on. Why? Because these machines are great. And they help us, and so I'm waiting for the more powerful machine that is so powerful and that we can show that it is needed that we have this incredibly powerful machine that we can't predict or understand why it has even acted in the situation, but it's still a really good idea for us to have. That's dangerous if we can't understand why it has come to the action that it's come to. Okay.
There's a sense of having the people, if there's all these questions about these machines that can start learning,
right,
and that are getting powerful and so on, and there's sort of I'm beginning to see more of aspects of the inevitability thing that are, and I mean.
think you've already had somebody say, well, how would you stop it?
Right.
But I mean, look, you know, isn't the cat already out of the bag?
Yeah, so, and I would answer the question the same way, right? Like, the cat is trying to come out of the bag. So a lot of the research that's happening on at least the kinds of robots that I'm talking about that can reason in this ethical way, this is still in an academic setting. So it's not a commercial product. It's not something that you're going to see in the next couple of years on the market. It's something that's very much in the experimental stage. And so I think that allows us a little bit more space, if we're in this experimental stage, for industry, for policymakers, for the public to decide, perhaps this isn't the direction that we should be going. And our resources, the millions of dollars that are being directed towards experimenting with these robots, should be redirected. So I think there is, and maybe that's me being naive, but I do think that there is the possibility to at least slow down the research in this area and redirect it, to steer it in a different direction. You think it's still inevitable? The robots are coming.
I was trying to think of which direction it's going to
be. Wow, the newspapers have really done a number on you, eh? The robots are coming.
Well, they're here. Okay, so any other questions for our speaker?
The complexity. If you consider humans as very complex systems, ultimately we are guided by a sense of ethics. And this has evolved over time when you're children up to adults and so on. Now, it is likely that when we get to the stage where robots are going to be very complex, there will be an evolution required for the robots to grow up and develop this sense of ethics. In other words, ultimately, the sense of ethics guides everything that the robot does. And there are special functions that the robot does.
My
feeling is that as technology evolves, we will.
Yeah.
In my lifetime, in somebody's lifetime, we will get there.
Yeah. I really like this image that you present with, ultimately we are guided by our sense of ethics and the robots will be or should be guided by their sense of ethics. But it's a different, so again, going back to the other question, ethics means something very different. I think robots should be guided by values like safety, security, transparency, accountability, and reliability, but not what does it mean to be a good person over my lifespan and, existential questions and whatnot. I don't think the robot can or should reason in that way, but should be a reliable machine and guided by that.
Why should not the robot reason that way? Because if the robot is sufficiently advanced in its intelligence, it should be doing that. Otherwise, we are creating a separate sort of like a alternative community that is subhuman.
Right, but if we make these, if we make them so that they can reason and think like that, we can't tell them that they have to do the dirty work and the jobs that we don't want to do.
That's the question.
It seems like such a fascinating endeavor that we're going to make them think and feel and be guided by ethics in the same way that we are, but they don't get to live a nice life that we do. They have to do our dirty, mundane.
This ultimately boils down to what people down south are doing with the people from further down south.
Right, yes, absolutely, right. Absolutely. So it's a question of humanity. And so then, again, I go back to the reason that was presented by James Gibbs about making these robots will give us a better understanding of our own morality. And I absolutely agree. We've just talked about, what our own morality means and how we treat other humans. So why would we make these robots that we're going to treat the same way that we treat underrepresented individuals? So then it's one thing to explore the making of these robots and then to have these questions, but it's a very different thing to make them into a commercial product and to release, and then to have this question, what is the legal status of this thing? What is the moral status? Is it a part of our moral community that's deserving of rights and protections? So I really like that though. Should the robot be guided by ethics in the same way that humans are? Thank you, Dr. Patel.
Okay.
Maybe we could
follow up. Yeah. We're going to soak every last minute out of it.
Okay.
Just because real life is very complicated, even we as humans, even if we are committed to specific ethical systems, most of the time, arguably, we just act based on our moral intuitions. We don't know really how to act, and we just follow our moral intuitions, which may be very inconsistent. And I was just wondering, what would that look like in the case of a computer? Would it have moral intuitions in a critical situation? Would it have inconsistent moral intuitions? Or
yeah.
The situation, would it be absolutely randomized? Or?
Yeah. Well, I think, I mean, this goes back to the issue of big data, inherent bias, and machine learning, right? So the moral intuitions, our moral intuitions are often guided by our upbringing, our culture, our nurture. And so I think the same thing would happen with the robot, just like the same thing happened with Tay. So the moral intuitions would be guided by the kinds of information that the robot learns and is taught. So perhaps the robot would have, you know, a robot that follows me around every day might have the same intuitions that I would mimic me. But a robot that follows somebody else around with a different cultural upbringing or religious background would have different moral intuitions. I think that's what it might look like. The robot would mimic if it's following one individual. So actually, okay, this is a good point. What would happen when we're talking about the robot having access to the decision-making of 1,000 people, 1,000,000 people from all over the world, and what would their intuitions look like? That's a really, really interesting question. Let's write a paper. And how would you test that? Actually, okay, question back to you. How would you test that? Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much. So end by thanking the Rotman Institute of Philosophy for sponsoring our event, and more importantly, thanking our great and stimulating and wonderful speaker, Aimee. Thank you very much.